Medical Center, Dr. De Keyser, and she's going to tell us about Gorham-Stout syndrome of the parietal bone, a rare case with a challenging treatment approach.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'd like to present an interesting case who was referred to our bone center in Rotterdam past year. Wait. The case is a 24-year-old young man. At the age of 6 years old, he and his parents noticed a small defect at the back of the head, and the defect became larger over time, and he did not know any known trauma. Furthermore, his medical history mentioned no relevant diseases. He did not use any medication. He has no other complaints, and actually was in quite a good condition. We performed lab tests, and they were all normal, especially there were no increase in inflammation markers or bone turnover markers, only a low vitamin D level. Well, the defect became larger over the time, with a diameter size of about 4 centimeters at the age of 15, to a diameter size of about 6 centimeters at the most recent CAT scan from 2018. And we made three-dimensional reconstructions of the CT scan to visualize the extensiveness of the defect. And just remember, this CAT scan and this previous CAT scan, this patient was in actually a quite good, healthy condition. And he had better have been a marathon runner, as is in the today's worldwide news at this moment. But he loved to play football, and with this large defect, he was playing football 3 times a week. So based on the clinical presentation and the radiological findings, the diagnosis of Gorham-Stout was most suspected. We didn't think about any malignancy based on his clinical presentation. And to confirm this diagnosis, we performed an MRI scan. And here you see the zone of diploic vascularity at the edge of the osteolytic region. And a periosteal reaction around in the soft tissue. So to conclude, we had a 24-year-old man with the diagnosis Gorham-Stout of the parietal bone of the skull. And we were challenged by the treatment approach to cover the defect with or without removal of all the affected bone and to start additional pharmacological treatment to stop the process of osteolysis. And due to the rarity of the disease and the lack of literature with respect to the underlying pathophysiological mechanism and no defined treatment strategy, we based our decision on a literature search in combination with a second opinion by the Expert Center in Boston. Well, Gorham-Stout disease is also named vanishing bone or phantom bone disease or idiopathic massive osteolysis. It has already been described in 1838 and reported a case with a complete vanishing of the humerus bone in about a period of 11 years. It's a rare disorder, and the disorder does not seem to exhibit a prevalence for race, geographic area, or sex, although it might be slightly more prevalent in males. It can occur at every age, but most of the cases present under the age of 40 years, with an average age at diagnosis of about 25 years, just the age as our patient has. Most of the cases have affected bones of the upper part of the body. They present with affected bodies, bones of the maxillofacial region, the ribs, the vertebrae, or the pelvic girdle. But in fact, every bone can be affected. It is, in most of the cases, monostotic, and the clinical presentation is with pain in most of the cases, but can be also with a fracture, and in a few cases, it's also complete asymptomatic. The characteristic pathophysiological of histological findings has been described in 1955 by Gorham and Stout, two persons, And they found that the massive osteolysis was accompanied with lymph angiomatosis and angiogenesis. And what they saw is that there was an endothelial-lined vessel proliferation into the bones. Endothelial-lined vessels were sprouting into the bone, and that way they destruct the bone matrix, with consequently the formation of fibrous tissue. And this fibrous tissue was not replaced by bone, new bone tissue. And with the advent of immunohistochemistry, it was found out that these endothelial-lined vessels were lymphatic vessels. And at this picture, you can see the lymphatic, the dilated lymphatic vessels in the soft tissue and also in the bone tissue with the destruction of the cortex. Currently, the underlying molecular mechanism or pathophysiological mechanism is not clarified yet. And in literature, there are several mechanisms proposed that have been associated with the osteolysis. For example, the activation of osteoclasts by cytokines of the immune system, the production of interleukin 6, which leads to the production of rank L and the activation of osteoclasts. There seems to be an important role by vascular endothelial growth factors, which are causing the sprouting of the lymphatic vessels. And another role may be by the anti-osteoclastic properties of calcitonin. Diagnosis is mostly based on patient history and on imaging data, and if available, pathology data can confirm the diagnosis, but lab tests are usually normal. Since the literature lacks the underlying pathophysiological mechanism and there are no randomized controlled trials that have been performed due to the rarity of the disease, there is no defined treatment strategy. And there, in literature, there are only case reports and they describe several pharmacological agents which are known, shown on this slide, which can be helpful in preventing the further osteolysis. And the pharmacological agents mostly target the inhibition of osteoclasts, the inhibition of the angiogenesis, or the suppression of the immune system. Surgical treatment can be applied if the patient complains about severe pain or impaired function, if there is a high risk of a fracture, or if there is already a fracture, or if complications occur, such as a chylothorax or an increased intracranial pressure. Radiation therapy may prevent further osteolysis by acting on the endothelial cell proliferation. Well, the prognosis of corum stout is unpredictable and also varying. It's based on the extent, the severity, and the localization of the disease. But in general, it's considered as a benign disease, which is slowly progressive, and its natural behavior is characterized by spontaneous resolution. Although, as stated on this slide, severe complications may occur, such as a chylothorax and an increased intracranial pressure, meningitis, and these complications are potentially life-threatening. Now, back to our case. We were challenged to define a proper treatment strategy with actually two goals. First, to protect the brain from mechanical injury locally at the defective zone. And second, to prevent further osteolysis in the future. And therefore, we also sent them to the neurosurgeon. And based on literature on comparable skull defects but with an underlying medical cause, there are actually two treatment approaches. First is to replace the affected bone with a three-dimensional printed P-graft without removal of all the affected bone. And a complication of this surgery approach is that the osteolysis continues around the graft with release of the graft and the potential necessity of repeat surgery. And the second approach is removal of the affected bone with also a margin of surrounding healthy bone tissue, with also replacement of this defect with a P-graft, But this is a more risky and a more invasive surgery with as potential complications and major bleeding from the venous sinuses, thrombosis, or in worst case scenario, death. And we will finally decide for our first surgical co-approach in combination with an intravenously supplied bisphosphonate acid. So to conclude, we present a rare bone disorder, a very rare interesting bone disorder, and an unique case with a large effect in this parietal bone. And our case is unique since it's only the third reported case in literature with a scorum stout disease of the parietal bone of the skull, and it's also the largest defect described. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for a very puzzling and extremely rare disease. What was the result of treating with zoledronate?
We are nowadays waiting for the results of Boston, but we, okay. Yeah, we are planning to do this next few months, I hope.
Okay. Sorry.
Not treated yet. The patient is not treated yet.
No, he's not treated yet. We are waiting for...
Not even with surgery. He doesn't have surgery yet.
No, we are waiting for the second opinion, but that will be the plan for the next month.
Do you have any histology on what's the bone remodeling like? You told us there are more lymphangiectasia, you have more blood vessels, so there's angiogenesis that's stimulated. What about bone remodeling? What are the osteoclasts in the lesion like? Are they normal? Are they multinuclear? Do they stain differently? What are the bone formation cells?
I'm not sure about the real morphologically of the osteoclast, but it's clear that there is an increase in osteoclast and a decrease in osteoblast in histology. And the idea is that you get the invasion of lymphatic vessels and they result in a zone of hyperemia in the bone. And this disrupts the normal bone balance and it leads to more osteoclast activity and actually sometimes a very low number of osteoblasts are seen.
So, I don't know
whether the osteoclasts differ from their function or from their staining.
And you don't have any staining on a piece of
bone? No, we don't have pathology data yet from our patient, but there is K2-40 staining which can stain the lymphatic cells, but not specific for quorum stout.
You say that you have based your diagnosis on MRI findings only. Is this correct?
Yeah.
How safe are you with this approach? I mean, without the biopsy, to put a diagnosis like that and also to design treatment based on simple MRI findings. I agree with you, but this is the most common diagnosis. But usually we perform a biopsy for histological documentation for this case.
Yeah, based on our radiologist, and we discussed it multidisciplinary, they can say that the diploic vascularity at the edge of the osteolytic region is actually quite characteristic for this disease.
You also have a differential diagnosis of 5 or 6 entities, and some of these were malignant. So how safe are you with this approach?
Our radiologist was quite sure about the diagnosis and also in combination with
You have
the
good radiologists, you mean?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, I'm happy. Please.
Thank you. Thank you for this nice presentation. It's over here.
Hi.
You clearly explained that we don't know anything about the pathophysiology of the disease, nor do we then know how to treat the disease. And you showed that there's two surgical options, either just remove... only the small part, or remove also some healthy bone. I wonder, what is the results of these two different approaches, since that can also help us to understand anything about the trigger for this disease?
Now, based according to our neurosurgeon and based on literature, we cannot say whether, because we were doubting about these two different approaches, since the second approach with the margin of surrounding healthy tissue, we maybe thought that we can cure the patient if we remove all the affected bone. But based on literature, we cannot say whether that will be the case. So that's not, there is no evidence for that in literature. So it is just the discussion, should we go for the less risky surgery that, or for the more invasive one? And yeah, since we have a lack of data, we will go for the first one. And going back to your first question about the treatment approach, yeah, well, there is no defined treatment strategy, and it will be of interest to know the exact trigger which will cause the lymphatic sprouting into the bone, since if we can, yeah, if you can find that, then you have a good target for therapy. But now all the therapies are described in case reports with mixed effects. And also we know that the natural progression is characterized by natural resolution. So it's not that if we give this patient bisphosphonates, we know that the stopping of the osteolysis is done by our therapy, but it can also be the natural course.
Please. There's a microphone there.
Microphone there, please.
Thanks very much for this very exciting disease. Now, are there any molecular analysis data just for to see if there's any molecular
studies? Do you mean genetic basis?
Genetic lesion.
Yeah, there are some studies done, but there's not a clear genetic currently. No. That's one of the research topics on this disease.
So there's
no
genetic?
Not yet, no.
Okay.
So we need genetic studies for this entity and Gorham's study. Okay, last one.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.